Gavel? Is there not note? It has already happened? All right. Good afternoon, everyone. We will take the cases up in the order in which they appear on the docket. And after argument in Rodriguez-Diaz versus Barr, which should be Garland, we will take a 5-minute recess and then return to do Klamath Irrigation District versus the Bureau of Reclamation. So Mitchell versus Corcoran, Council, you may proceed.
Thank you, Your Honor. Good afternoon, Stephen Lubliner, on behalf of Appellant James Mitchell. May it please the court, I hope to reserve 1 minute for rebuttal.
And okay, watch your clock.
I will, yes, thank you, Your Honor. I'll be speaking principally this morning on the Feretta claim, which in this context arises principally under 2254 D2, state court decision based on an unreasonable determination of the facts in light of the evidence in the state court record. And that's an important distinction because it, I think, effectively eliminates much if not all of the precedent that the state relies on. The Moore case, which tries to read the references to timing and Feretta into a holding, arose under D1. The Marshall case followed Moore on D1. Stenson followed Moore on D1. Now, Marshall did also alternatively deny relief under 2254 D2, but like most cases involving a factual case-specific determination, it's distinguishable and it can't dictate the outcome in this case. Now, the question of whether there was an objectively reasonable determination of the facts in light of the evidence in the record, I submit it has to be grounded in common sense and day-to-day familiar reality, including the norms of human behavior. And one norm of human behavior in this context, the norm of behavior of typical criminal defendants, is that the decision for self-representation is often not made at the outset of the case. Criminal defendants do not go into court like you go into a restaurant and you get a menu and someone might order the special filet mignon.
This may be, but this request was made at the eve of trial, and the trial judge, once he did initially grant it, but once he learned that later that the defendant needed 4 additional weeks to prepare, the trial judge felt that was unreasonable given the amount of preparation that had already been put into the case, the jury selection, some of the elderly witnesses. And so why was that objectively unreasonable for the California Court of Appeals to conclude this wasn't a Feretta violation?
Well, even the Wyndham case, on which the Court of Appeal relied heavily and the government relies heavily in some of the cases of this court site, even the Wyndham case in the California Supreme Court said when the lateness of the request and even the necessity of a continuance can be reasonably justified, the request should be granted. Now, in cases like this, it really is compelling, as I say, to suggest what was Mr. Mitchell supposed to do. Now, I think he proceeded on the chronology that we have as expeditiously as was humanly possible. And that's one thing that distinguishes this case from the Marshall case, where the court noted there wasn't a lot of discussion about the facts and the triggering considerations in Marshall, but the court noted he had 6 times in which to assert his dissatisfaction with counsel, and he didn't avail himself of those opportunities, and so on the eve of trial, it wasn't unreasonable to say that the request was too late. Now, in this case, we have a very tight chronology, and we know a lot about the case. We know that on January 10th, Mr. Mitchell was given comfort by his current counsel, Mr. Hanlon. Yes, we're going to go forward on Mr. Mitchell's chosen defense of absolute innocence, and we're not going to be pursuing the heat of passion manslaughter case. And so again, the question, what else was Mr. Mitchell supposed to do? Was he supposed to prophylactically discharge counsel out of some deeply held suspicion that counsel was going to betray him and change his mind eventually and proceed on his own, when that's clearly that his self-representation is clearly the disfavored alternative on the menu? And I think it's unreasonable to say that he should have gone, okay, the next day, January 11th, maybe I should ask to represent myself. Or January 18th, maybe I should ask to represent myself. From what we know on the state court record, things started to fall apart. He had strong suspicions that things were falling apart in May. On May 10th, he said, I'd like the public defender. And he didn't get the public defender. And so it's reasonable to assume he made his Feretta request then and said, oh, I need 4 more weeks to prepare. The trial court would have said the same thing it said when he made the Feretta request. Well, I understand your concerns, Mr. Mitchell. 4 weeks makes a lot of sense, but it's too late. So
well, I don't know that we know that. I mean, that seems speculative. I mean, here the Mr. Mitchell had a history of difficult relationships with various different lawyers, and then eventually, very soon before trial, he asked to represent himself, a request that was initially granted, but the trial judge then realized that there was a substantial disruption associated with the request. Once Mr. Mitchell said he then needed 4 weeks, which the trial judge wasn't even sure would be enough time even then, given some of the complexities of the case. So again, I mean, whether the trial judge could have granted this request and delayed the trial, maybe, but was it objectively unreasonable for the California Court of Appeals to look at this and say this was not a violation of clearly established law?
Well, I think it was objectively unreasonable on the facts in light of the evidence in the state court record under 2254 D2, and we have to distinguish in this context Mr. Mitchell's difficult relationship with trial counsel based on the emotions he brought to bear on the situation and his difficult relationship with trial counsel based on the very real considerations of wanting to limit his defense to complete innocence and not go down the road of lesser included offenses like manslaughter, which in a case like this, in a context like this, well, it's who are they going to seize on as doing this? And the jury is going to put the emotional hash together with did he do it? It's going to totally undermine his case for complete innocence. Now we have.
Hey, did you have a question? We can't hear you. Judge Bumate, are you muted?
Test. Hello? Oh, there we go. Sorry, counsel. Is there something that prompted the Feretta request on June 10th? What exactly prompted it?
Well, I think first the denial of the public defender on May 10th, which was...
Well, that's a full month before that.
Well, and there was not a lot that happened in the interim, and I detail that chronology, which is very important and distinguishes this from the Marshall case. On May 25th, Mr. Hanlon went to court, and he asked for money for a psychological expert, a psychiatric expert. And he said very explicitly, you know, Mr. Mitchell, he's much different than what he said in January. Mr. Mitchell, yeah, he's going to testify that he... didn't commit this crime and other people committed the crime, but I may not argue that. Whether I argue that, that's up to me. I may not argue that. And I
so that's
know.
May 25th, you were saying?
That's May 25th.
Okay, so that's 15 days before June 10th.
And then after May 25th, the court went on the conclusion of the May 25th hearing. They wished the court well on the court's 3-to-3-week vacation that's coming up. And the next hearing is the June 10th hearing after Mr. Hanlon went on the record on May 25th saying, I don't even know if legally I'm allowed to put on a defense that undermines my client and contradicts him, but, you know, if you give me the money, I'm going to do it. And he didn't get the money right then. He got maybe $2,000. And then the judge goes on vacation for 3 weeks. June 10th, they come back, bang, Feretta. So on this, and I point out again, going back to the Wyndham case, Wyndham even says the rationale underlying the Supreme Court's decision in Feretta is not difficult to understand. But quite simply, The state may not constitutionally prevent a defendant charged with the commission of a criminal offense from controlling his own fate by forcing on him counsel who may present a case which is not consistent with the actual wishes of the defendant. So that's a very serious consideration. How it developed in this case is, I'd say, mathematically, practically established in the record, and Mr. Mitchell acted as expeditiously as humanly possible in trying to vindicate his concerns, both first with asking for the preferred new assistance of counsel, and then when he didn't get that, and it was clear that Hanlon was going to betray him, insisting on the Faretta, on his Faretta rights, which he should have been granted.
Mr. Bloodliner, do you want to save your time?
Thank you, Honor. I can submit the sentencing issue on the briefs, and I'll reserve my time. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Rose?
Good afternoon, Your Honors. Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor. The court has made the two points that I would stress in my own argument. First, that this Faretta request was made on the eve of trial. There were jurors, 1,000 jurors had been screened for hardship and for cause challenges. There were 100 jurors in the courtroom waiting to be voir dired. Witnesses were subpoenaed. The two elderly 80-year-old eyewitnesses were being held. This was 2 years in the making for this trial. So certainly under the Wyndham factors in California, and which are authorized by Marshall v. Taylor, by this court's jurisprudence, the Court of Appeal made a reasonable decision on the facts. The other point is that Mr. LeBlanc seems to suggest that this was a sudden realization by petitioner that this that his attorney was going to make the alternative arguments. In fact, this had been the same dialogue that Mr. Mitchell had been having with all of his attorneys, the two previous ones, Mr. Hallinan and Mr. Horngrath, that he had fired, and Mr. Hanlon for months and months and months. And the Court of Appeal made a specific factual finding that in fact there had been ongoing discussions between Mr. Mitchell and Mr. Hanlon regarding this exact subject, and that Mr. Hanlon hadn't even made a final decision as of the date of the Faretta motion. He didn't make a decision until weeks later about whether he was going to go ahead and argue the alternative ground. So there was no precipitating event on the day before the trial was about to begin that caused Mr. Mitchell to understand anything different than his voluminous discussions with Mr. Hanlon through the months and months and months, which were the same discussions he'd been having with Mr. Hallinan and Mr. Horngrath all along, when all three of these extremely excellent attorneys were trying to convince him he didn't have a chance on an actual innocence defense. So nothing had changed at the eve of trial. It was the eve of trial. It was too late under Marshall v. Taylor. It was too late under the California Wyndham factors. And as the court, I think, has pointed out, there is no showing in any degree of an unreasonable finding by the California Court of Appeal on either of these points, deficient performance or prejudice. If the court has any questions, I'd be happy to discuss further. But if not, I'd be prepared to submit.
Well, counsel argues that it wasn't until May 20, well, it wasn't until after the May 25th hearing, sometime after that, Mitchell learned that his counsel was actually going to act against his wishes. And the next opportunity he had to assert his Faretta rights was the June 10th hearing. How do you respond to that?
There's nothing in the record to support that contention. The Court of Appeal, as I say, made a factual finding that these conversations have been ongoing for months and months and months, in fact, for years, but with this particular attorney for months. And the attorney had stated later that he did not decide finally which way to go on this, because it's obviously a delicate matter emotionally and legally. He hadn't made a final decision until weeks after this Faretta motion in the beginning of June. So there's absolutely nothing in the record to support a precipitating event on June 3rd.
I had a question on the sentencing. Do you think it was reasonable to say that the performance of counsel was adequate when he didn't make any argument at all?
At first blush, it perhaps seems questionable, but if you think about the situation, it's a bit bizarre for appellant to be complaining that counsel didn't make an argument, because that's exactly what he requested. The only rational argument, and in fact, appellant in his brief concedes that the only rational argument for concurrent sentences involved the facts of the case, conceding that appellant was guilty, but that his personal intent in the case was a single intent, and it was a single course of behavior rather than two different behaviors. So in order to make a rational argument on those grounds, counsel would have had to concede that appellant was guilty, which is exactly what appellant has all along requested counsel not to do. So for him now to claim that he didn't make that argument is odd. Counsel did exactly what appellant requested him to do. The idea that he didn't stand by prepared to object to anything improper was rejected by the California Court of Appeal and the court below, the district court below. Counsel never said, I'm going to absent myself. He just said, I'm not making that argument. I can't make that argument. He told me not to make that argument, and I can't make any other rational argument than that. Appellant in his brief concedes that's the only argument to have been made, so he didn't make it. He was there. The Court of Appeal found that if something untoward had happened, something improper had happened, Mr. Hanlon was there and he was on the job. It wasn't a complete absence of deprivation of counsel. And then just briefly,
can we just pause on that point though? I mean, there is a prejudice question, but why couldn't Hanlon, consistent with his views of the case, have still tried to make an argument on the concurrent sentencing point? And said, you know, the kidnapping was really part and parcel of the murder, and it should therefore be concurrent. I mean, was there something that would have caused him to get in trouble with his client if he had made that argument?
Well, yes, Your Honor. That argument can't be made in the abstract. It wasn't a kidnapping is a part and parcel of a murder. It was this kidnapping of this child, his child, was part and parcel of this murder of his wife. So Hanlon couldn't voice that argument without conceding that appellant had killed his wife and kidnapped his own child, which is exactly what Mitchell attempted to forbid counsel from doing. So it's not, as I say, it's not an abstract argument. It did entail the exact concession that counsel was trying to avoid making. And then very briefly on prejudice, as I say, in his brief, counsel concedes that that was the only argument to be made for concurrent sentences. This judge knew sat at the trial. He knew appellant backwards and forwards. He knew of his domestic violence. He knew of his history. He knew of his inheritance. He knew of everything about this guy. He knew the facts of the case. The judge had been through 2 years of the extremely talkative appellant in the courtroom. This judge knew everything about this case. There was nothing any reasonable, and counsel has not proposed any reasonable argument that could have been made that the judge wasn't completely familiar with in this case.
Question: so, did Mitchell make the argument that it should be concurrent also during his?
No. He said it wasn't me. That's all. That's what he wanted all along. It was not. I had nothing to do with
it. He argued it wasn't him at the sentencing.
Yes, he absolutely refused to admit that he was guilty of murder. It was the two drug dealers that had beaten his wife to death. It was not him. He was absolutely innocent. That was what he was adamant about all along. Which was an argument that any rational person who observed this trial knew had no colorable basis whatsoever.
All right. Thank you, counsel.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Mr. Lubliner.
Thank you, Your Honor. Briefly on the sentencing point, Mr. Mitchell wanted counsel at sentencing. Hanlon refused to be counsel at sentencing. He said, I'll be the body. He was the body. He was the sleeping lawyer. Mr. Mitchell was denied counsel at sentencing. Going back to the Feretta argument, I don't understand the point about Hanlon not having made up his mind until the jury instruction conference about what he was going to do. If that's a test by which, when Mr. Mitchell had a ripened Feretta right, then he certainly had it when he had doubts long before that. Just to conclude, if you look at the timeline, if you look at the considerations where Mr. Mitchell was given comfort in January and when the problems developed, And the first chance that he could have asserted them after it was clear that he was going to be betrayed, it was June 10th, and the conclusions to the contrary that he forfeited his rights were unreasonable.
All right. Thank you, Counsel Mitchell.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you both for an excellent argument. Mitchell versus Corcoran and Davey is submitted.